We are back with the top 32 of the 150th Yu-Gi-Oh! Championship Series event. For our top 32 feature match, we have Justin Huskey using a Burning Abyss deck that features Mass Change 2, dueling against Galo.
Orbea.
Orbea Davila, who is using a Necros deck. Galo is using an interesting tech card. We've seen a lot of players using lots of different cards to deal with Ginlock if the opponent is able to pull that off. I don't believe we have yet seen anyone using Camera Clops.
Yeah, so basically the idea is that you want to have a warrior that you can search with reinforcements of the army that can out an opposing Djinn. The most popular one this weekend was probably Bull Blader, which has a very, very similar effect to Camera Clops. And for those of you at home that don't know what Camera Clops does, when it declares an attack on a monster who has higher defense than its attack, it destroys it without going to damage calculation. So basically the key difference between that and Bull Blader is that Bull Blader has to go to damage calc. So if it attacks a monster with higher attack than itself, it will still die by battle, even though it kills the other monster with its effect. So in this way, Camera Clops will survive battles that Bull Blader wouldn't. And it still has low enough attack, 1400, to destroy things like Necros of Claw Sloss, Necros of Valkyries, Necros of Trishula, etc.
So Camera Clops is an interesting choice for getting rid of monsters that are protected by Ginlock and other cards that assist that combination of cards. But that won't be particularly relevant here, as Huskey is not using a Necros deck that relies on that strategy. He's using the Burning Abyss deck. He is using two copies of Mass Change 2, as I mentioned earlier. Mass Change 2 has been a popular card in Burning Abyss decks. We haven't seen it in any of the Burning Abyss decks we featured today, but it does have the potential to turn any Burning Abyss monster, or rather any Burning Abyss monster in the main deck, as well as Tour Guide from the Underworld, into Masked Hero Dark Law. We saw Dark Law in our round one feature match on the stream yesterday, and as was evident there, it is a powerful card that is powerful against a lot of the top decks. Necros is one of those decks that is affected by Masked Hero Dark Law. Dark Law banishes all cards that would be sent to your opponent's graveyard instead of those cards going to the graveyard. And with Necros decks needing to send cards to their graveyard, banish cards from their graveyard, and so much more to pull off their effects, Dark Law can shut them down. In addition, Dark Law's effect will get a card out of your opponent's hand whenever they add a card to their hand during their outside of their draw phase. And since Necros decks, like Gallo's deck, constantly search his deck for cards to add to his hand, Husky's Masked Hero Dark Law can basically tear apart Gallo's strategy and really make it difficult for him to think his plays through and know exactly where his turn is going.
Yeah, another key aspect to Justin Husky's deck is that he's playing two copies of Vanny's Fiend and two copies of Majesty's Fiend, which are both fairly strong against Necros. What's super unfortunate for Galo is that although Camera Clops is very, very good at outing the Ginlock and cards like El Shaddoll and Noyatilis, Vanny's Fiend actually has 1,200 defense, whereas Camera Clops' attack is 1,400. So Camera Clops won't be able to destroy a Vanny's Fiend, whereas a Bull Blader in that scenario would.
That's an interesting interaction and an interesting disadvantage of Camera Clops in this particular matchup. It's also interesting, Justin Huskey is using a card called Fiend Griefing. This is one of the new cards in Cross Souls. Robbie can tell us about that card.
Okay, so Fiend Griefing says, target one monster in your opponent's graveyard and shuffle it into the deck. Then you can send one Fiend-type monster from your deck to the graveyard. So basically for Burning Abyss, this allows you to disrupt what your opponent's doing. So for example, they'll activate a Necros Cycle with a Djinn in the graveyard, or they'll activate Necros Mirror with Shrit in the graveyard, trying to banish them to get the requirements to summon a Ritual Monster. And you can chain Fiend Griefing, banish the card, then also send a Burning Abyss monster from your deck to the graveyard and trigger that effect. So that will also cause your opponent to be forced to resolve whatever ritual spell they're using. So you can catch them in ways that they don't initially expect and even get a card out of it because your Burning Abyss that you send to the graveyard will trigger. So such as like Grav, Skarm, Sir, etc. And you can also use it to out a Djinn because you can just send Farfa to banish the Djinn and similar cards. So even if he can't find an optimal situation to shuffle a monster back to cause Galo to stumble somehow, he can still just use Fiend Griefing basically as a foolish burial for a fiend. So it's very, very cool.
Okay, so Husky's deck is using a trap lineup consisting of 12 trap cards. Those are 3 Karma Cuts, 2 Breakthrough Skill, 2 Dimensional Prison, 2 Fiend Griefing, 1 Fire Lake of the Burning Abyss, 1 Bottomless Trap Hole, and 1 Vanity's Emptiness. Galo is not using any trap cards in his deck, as appears to be a trend in a lot of Necro's decks.
Yes, he's also only using 3 spell outs. So Raigeki, Dark Hole, and Book of Eclipse as removal for Jin. Cards like Dark Law, Elshad al-Noitilis, because he's relying so heavily on Camera Clops. So it's interesting to see what will happen here with that.
Okay, so the duel is underway. Galo started off by discarding Necros of Clausulis from his hand and adding a Ritual spell card from his deck to his hand.
Yeah, I'm adding Necros of Kaleidoscope, a pretty standard play here. He's most likely going to send Herald of the Arclight to summon Necros Unicorn and then get a search off the Herald of the Arclight.
That is exactly what just happened, and that is a common first turn.
Yeah.
He's using his Arclight's effect.
What's interesting here is that depending on Galo, if Galo knows whether or not his opponent's playing Burning Abyss, or specifically if he's not playing Necroz, right? In the Necroz mirror match, you want to get rid of your monsters, get rid of your cards from the field, so that they can't use their Necroz of Trishula, because you have to have a card in every zone for it to banish. But against decks like Shadal or Burning Abyss that rely so heavily on Xyz monsters and extra deck monsters in general, leaving up a Unicorn is usually pretty strong, especially because you can search cards like Necroz of Valkyris off the Herald of Arclight when you summon it. So you get the guaranteed protection with the summon, so it's pretty much free, because you're using 2 cards, the Ritual Spell and the Unicorn, to summon a Unicorn and add a card to protect it.
Yes. Seems like whether or the play he makes this turn might indicate to us whether or not he knows what Justin is using.
Yes. It's interesting that he chose to use... He searched Necroz of Bryonic and then searched for a Necroz of Unicorn to discard to add back the Bryonic.
Okay. So based on that, it seems likely that he knows his opponent is not using a Necroz deck, right?
Correct. But it also means that he might specifically know he's on Burning Abyss, because Dante won't be able to attack over a Necroz Unicorn because its effects negate, whereas
right.
like a deck like Shadal would just be able to attack over if they have a Shadal fusion.
Right. For those who don't know, Necroz of Unicorn negates the effects of all monsters special summoned from the extra deck.
Indeed. So even though the Dante can pay cost and send 3 cards from the deck to the graveyard, it won't receive the point boost.
Okay, so in Justin Husky's hand, we have Sir Malebranche of the Burning Abyss, Farfa Malebranche of the Burning Abyss, Mathematician, Scarm Malebranche of the Burning Abyss, Darkhold, and Karma Cut.
Yeah, and seeing as he doesn't have a good way to clear the Unicorn without just sending a Farfa with Mathematician and banishing it for a turn, which doesn't really accomplish anything because it'll just get 1,500 points in, he'll set his cards in an attempt to remove the Unicorn with something more efficient such as Karma Cut, completely banishing it, and then also getting a Burning Abyss trigger off of that. But this also opens up to him potentially getting Necroz of Trishulid. If Galo simply attacks over the monster and he puts a card in his opponent's graveyard, he'll then have a card in every zone. And because Husky also set Darkhold, that means his cards aren't necessarily chainable. So he can't just activate both of his cards in response to the Ritual spell that would summon Necroz of Trishula, causing him to have no cards in play when the Trishula hits. He also has too many cards in hand for the Karma Cut to discard his last card to put him to 0 cards in hand. So he has no way to actually play around Necroz of Trishula here.
Yes, this definitely seemed like a risky play. If Galo summons Necroz of Trishula, which appears to be very likely at this point, he will be able to successfully use its effect.
Yeah, what's even worse is that if Husky chooses to Karma Cut the Unicorn, Galo can just, because Galo will no longer have a monster in play, he can banish the Necroz of Kaleidoscope with another Necroz card to add another Ritual spell to his hand. So it makes the summoning of Necroz of Trishula even easier and more efficient. So
he activates Reinforcement of the Army and uses its effect to add Necroz of Clausulus to his hand, then discards Necroz of Clausulus to add Necroz Kaleidoscope to his hand. He activates the Kaleidoscope next and sends another Herald of the Arclight from his extra deck to his graveyard to special summon another Necroz of Unicorn. Of course, once again, he gets to use the Herald of the Arclight's effect to add a Ritual card from his deck to his hand.
So by Galo using the Necrozma Bryonic on his first turn to add Necrozma Unicorn, then discarding the Necrozma Unicorn to add back the Necrozma Bryonic, he's basically just trying to bluff a Necrozma Valkyries there. However, it also means that he has no more copies of Necrozma Unicorn in his deck because he's used one last turn, summoned one, and then had to search another from his deck with Necrozma Bryonic. So now he's out of Unicorns, which doesn't seem like the biggest deal, but in the later game when you're trying to do things like Kaleidoscope out of Valkyries in a Unicorn, etc., or need it to get back a monster, it might actually hinder him.
So he took a second Necros of Krishala with this search from his Herald of the Arclight.
I think that's a very, very good play, because that means that when he summons the first Necroz of Trishlin and activates his effect, even if Huskey has something like Effect Veil or Fiendish Chain or Breakthrough Skill, which seems likely given on what he played, he can use the second Necroz of Trishlin to negate the effect, because Necroz of Trishlin says when a Necroz monster is targeted by a card effect, you can discard, negate, and destroy the card that targets it. So it's actually, it seems this tournament specifically, it's been very common to see two Necroz of Trishlin in a lot of decks. And I think this might be the breakout of when people have decided to play two versus one.
Yes, Jerome and I were actually talking about that during the last round. He mentioned that it gained some popularity in Europe, mm-hmm. where it appears to have picked up. And now here, it's coming over to the States, and duelists are using it here as well.
Yeah.
A lot of players are still using only one copy of Necroz of Krishala, but two copies is definitely gaining popularity.
Yeah, I believe they've been doing in the OCG for the past two Forbidden and Limited lists there, so that also might be a trend picking up, seeing how they have adapted to the limitations on particular cards, and then using that there. So
So now, does Galo have a way to summon Krishala this turn?
Yeah, he should. Worst comes to worst, he can just summon a Diamond Direwolf and destroy his field, right, to get rid of all of his monsters, and then banish ritual spells from his graveyard to add Necroz Mirror.
He could do that.
Yeah, and then because he has Bryonic, or Necroz of Bryonic and Necroz of Colossus already in his grave, that's the 6 and the 3 for the total level 9 to summon the Trishula.
That is true.
However, this could go fairly poorly if Galo manages to target the Dark Hole, because depending on what happens after that, then the other card's chainable. It's Karma Cut. So Huskey might be able to use it, getting rid of all the cards he has in play, so then the Necroz of Trishula wouldn't resolve. But, yeah.
Okay, and he did make that play that you suggested. He exceeds summon Diamond Dire Wolf, and then uses his effect to destroy itself along with Husky's Dark Hole. By destroying both of those cards, he left himself without a field, which allows him to banish Necroz Kaleidoscope and Necroz of Unicorn from his graveyard. With that, he can search his deck for Necroz Mirror.
Yeah, there.
And that is exactly what he'll take. By using the Necroz Mirror, he can tribute monsters from his, banish monsters from his graveyard to pay the cost for his ritual summons. As you mentioned before, he has a level 6 and a level 3 in his graveyard, so he can banish them to summon the Krishula.
Correct. So because he has another copy of Kaleidoscope here, and he knows that the only way to get back the Necroz ritual spells is usually with Unicorn or Preparation of Rites. So because he, not necessarily recklessly, but chose to use all of his Unicorns so quickly, he now won't have access to the Necroz of Kaleidoscope for the rest of the game unless he drew Preparation of Rites, and then needing to draw one of is much more difficult than it would be otherwise. Here he's trying to banish both copies of the ritual spell, Necroz Kaleidoscope, but I'm pretty sure it says you can only use the effect of this once per turn, but it might just talk about the ritual spell activation itself. So they're clarifying, because I'm pretty sure his Necroz Kaleidoscope was a foreign card. He brings out a translation, shows the judge to clarify. So we'll see how that works. Presumably, if he picks up his deck and continues searching, then he'll... yeah, so then you can use both effects, because it's only the activation of Necroz Kaleidoscope, not the usage of the banish effect.
So he has Necro Cycle to his hand. Both of his Kaleidoscopes are now banished, so even with Preparation of Rites, none of them are coming back.
Yeah. So here comes down Trishula. I assume Justin Huskey has two cards in hand, because I'm pretty sure he had Mathematician and additional Burning Abyss. So, like I said before, he won't be able to get rid of all the cards in his own, but he'll just chain the Karmica just to try to mitigate some of it. Oh, yeah, he has three cards. That's a lot. So he's discarding Farfa here, because if he discards the Sir, what Galo can do is either choose to banish the Sir or banish the Skarm, regardless of which one, and it would mitigate the Sur's effect. Because as Sur says, when it's sent to the graveyard, you can special summon a Burning Bit sponsor from your graveyard. However, Necro's Attritula removing the Skarm would remove the target for Sur. Or, because the Sur was put into the graveyard and then hasn't activated yet, and it's in the middle of the chain, if Necro's Attritula removes it from the graveyard before it has the chance to activate, it will not resolve. Or it will never activate, basically, because it has to stay in the same place where it needs to activate.
It's important to note that Necro's Attritula's effect does happen upon resolution. You don't target... You choose the cards at resolution. You don't target the three cards. So if he were to discard the Sur and use his effect to special summon a monster, there would be no way to protect that monster from Attritula's effect if Gela wanted to banish it. Since he chooses... He basically chooses whether or not to banish it right before it gets banished.
Yeah.
Once he chooses, there's no chance to respond.
This game is actually a pretty typical showcase of how the Necroz Burning Abyss matchup goes if the Burning Abyss player doesn't draw some card that can hinder the Necroz player in some way.
So he uses Mathematician now, kicks one of his Burning Abyss cards to the graveyard, and attacks directly.
Yeah, he sends a Graph, to which will then special summon the Skarm from his deck, which then destroys itself, and then end phase he gets to search, presumably Tour Guide from the Underworld. And then I'm not quite sure what his back row is, but it was whatever he drew for turn. Hopefully it's a trap card good enough to get him out of this, or maybe... I guess it could possibly be Mass Chang second. He does play a single copy of Mass Hero Dian in his extra deck, which means he can upgrade the Mathematician if he needs to. And the fact that he's searching... He chose not to add the Tour Guide, and he's shuffling it to find another monster, and that probably means that his set card is a discard card. So it's either Mass Change second, or Karma Cut, or a similar Phoenix Wing Blast Raigeki-esque effect, because he wants to be able to pay the cost for the card without discarding something like Tour Guide, which is a very, very good card to have in your hand.
That's a good point. You're probably right about that. Gallo might actually realize that just as you have, and now play around a potential card that has a cost of discarding a card.
Yeah, and in that way, he might choose not to Necroz of Trishula, because... Because he just drew Shrit Shash of the Necroz, which means he can potentially pay for the entire cost of Necroz of Trishula thanks to Necroz of Shrit, because it can count as the full ritual. But then when he does that and activates Trishula's effect, Huskey can chain the discard trap, get rid of the last card in his hand, and because he no longer has a card in hand, Trishula resolves without effect. But yeah, as I was saying earlier, this is pretty typical of the match when the Burning Abyss player doesn't draw a card like Majesty's Fiend, Vanny's Fiend, Mass Change Second, etc. Because those are the cards that really hinder Necroz for more than a single effect. Something like Breakthrough Skill, for example, or a Karma Cut, or a Dimensional Prison, these other trap cards he has in his deck, might trade one for one, or just use like a stop a single effect, etc. But that's usually not nearly enough against Necroz, because their graveyard is such a good resource. They can banish ritual spells, get more ritual spells, use cards like Shrit to add more warriors. When he sends Herald the Arclight, he gets another card to his hand. Necroz is very, very efficient at managing resources, which is super important.
And we're seeing that right now as Galo banishes Necroz Mirror and Necroz of Clausalis from his graveyard to add another Necroz Mirror to his hand.
Yeah, I think he... Initially, like, because he doesn't have another... Yeah, so he's going to use Necroz of Bryonic to most likely search Necroz of Valkyrus here. Because he has Shrit, and he knows that the trap card is most likely a discard trap. So what he can do is activate the ritual spell. Probably discard Shrit, because he already banished the Unicorn, so he can't use Necroz Mirror banishing two level fours to summon the Valkyrus. And then when the discard trap is... If the discard trap is activated to try to get rid of the Valkyrus, he can discard his Trishula to negate it. So... This also plays around where he doesn't have to commit a Trishula. Also, Huskey might not know that Gallo plays two copies of Trishula, because he only saw him search a copy and then summon a copy. So even though Husky's play does inherently play around Trishula, it might not necessarily be because he's expecting Trishula, but more so he's like low on resources. So Gallo activates Necroz Cycle here. He's most likely discarding Shrit, but he's considering what to special summon. He might just special summon Unicorn here, because Unicorn still negates the effects of extra deck monsters, and you'll get the Search of Shrit.
Very interesting. Now we see Fiend Griefing. As Robbie mentioned before, this card has two effects, both of which are beneficial to whoever activates it. It shuffles a card from your opponent's graveyard back into their deck, and then sends a fiend from your deck to your graveyard. So he sends... Looks like he was about to send Necros of Unicorn back to the deck. Looks like he's still deciding.
He has to send the fiend before the Griefing resolves. But specifically, it shuffles back monsters. So you can't use it against ritual spells, which is very, very important.
So he's sending, looks like, Graf, Malbranch of the Burning Abyss from his deck to his graveyard, and shuffling the Necros of Unicorn back into Gallo's deck. If Graf's effect doesn't activate yet, right?
No, it won't. It'll activate a new chain, but it's interesting here that, one, he searched the Burning Abyss because I thought it would be a discard trap. He could have potentially sent Libic, and then in a new chain, Libic would have activated to special summon the Burning Abyss from his hand, because Libic says when it's sent to the graveyard, you special summon Burning Abyss from your hand. But that's not what he should... Oh, he's doing basically what I said before, but instead he's doing an extra step by sending Graf first. He's then going to send the Libic, which will then destroy itself to special summon the Sir. But I think he should have just gone directly to the Libic, because he's basically getting rid of a Graf and using a Graf for no reason. I guess he's thinning his deck by a card to try to like find an out that may be better, such as Tour Guide, but at the same time, it's not exactly the best. Also, here, Galo shows a lot of diligence in not summoning Necroz of Trishula, because if your opponent activates Fiend Griefing, sending a Graf, I think I would still summon the Necroz of Trishula, because there, it's curious as to like what card they have in hand, and even though, because he didn't directly send Libic, the Libic wouldn't get the monster out of the hand by the time that the Trishula resolves.
For anyone who doesn't know at home, the Burning Abyss monsters all have effects, at least the main deck ones, all have effects that destroy themselves if a non-Burning Abyss monster is on the field along with them. That includes face-down monsters. The effect of Libic is when it's destroyed, you can special summon a Burning Abyss monster from your hand, and that monster's effect is negated. That's what happened here. Now, Sir is on the field, special summoned by Libic, and its effect is negated. With its effect negated, it won't self-destruct when a non-Burning Abyss is on the field.
Yeah, and because I'm not necessarily sure if Mathematician is an optional effect, I think that's why Galo picked it up, because his play, realizing that he can force Huskey to have a card in hand when he goes for Necroz of Trishula, might have been if... Let's see, when this card is destroyed by balance into the graveyard, you can draw one card. Okay, so Huskey chose to draw a card off Mathematician, whereas he could have chosen not to, and then not gotten Necroz of Trishulid.
Right.
But Galo read it, trying to check if it's a mandatory, realized it wasn't, figured there's no value in not trying to attack over it, because Huskey still might not know he uses two copies of Trishulid, although now he does after the match. And then he gets to put a card into Husky's hand by destroying it by battle, because the effect of Mathematician lets him draw a card. And he has the Cern play already, and that's perfect for Necroz of Trishula to just finish the game. And with zero resources, Husky just concedes.
Right. As you mentioned before, Husky didn't know that Galo had two copies of Necroz of Trishula. Would you have drawn a card there if it was your Mathematician being attacked?
I think Husky's line was pretty correct. You don't necessarily know if they're playing two Necroz of Trishula. And at that point, you're in such a poor losing position that... You might as well just draw the card. The odds are that they, even if the odds are 50%, right, that they do or don't play Necroz of Trishula, that's still probably better odds than you winning if you don't draw the card.
I agree 100%. Even if there was a much lower chance that your opponent is using two copies of Necroz of Trishula, I think you have to take a big risk there and draw that card, because you're not going to get ahead by not drawing cards and not taking risks when you're that far behind.
Indeed. It would have been very different if Galo hadn't used a Necroz of Trishula, or even if, let's say, Galo used all of his search effects that turn, and then you're just considering whether or not he might have a Trishula in hand because he hasn't used one. There, I might not draw, because I feel like it's very likely that he'll have a Trishula because he didn't search it previously throughout that turn. But in this specific scenario, I think Husky's line was correct, even though it looked like he played right into Trishula.
Yes.
So looking at what Galo's going to side in, I see a bunch of Royal Decrees, a few other cards. Husky, I saw side in Crush Card Virus, but Galo does not have access to the Fire Hand, so he won't be able to do anything cool against Crush Card, unfortunately.
Yes. So in Husky's side deck, we have one copy of Fiend Griefing, two copies of Trap Tricks, Trap Hole Nightmare, one copy of Fire Lake of the Burning Abyss, a Crush Card Virus, another Majesty's Fiend paired with another Vanity's Fiend, 3 copies of Mystical Space Typhoon, 3 copies of Fairy Wind, and 2 copies of the Monarch Storm 4th. Do you think there's a good chance he's going to bring in more of the Majesty's Fiend and the Vanity's Fiend along with the Monarch Storm 4th?
I very much think so. So we already previously talked about how good Majesty's Fiend and Vanity's Fiend are against Necroz, because one hinders special summons, the other hinders effects. And Necroz is a very effect-centric deck, because you need to use so many cards such as Necroz of Baryonic, Necroz of Colossalis, etc. to search cards in order to summon them. So in some ways, Majesty's Fiend plays a similar role as Vanity's Fiend. And because Necroz can get so many free wins off of summoning a ritual monster used or summoned by using a gen release or rituals, Monarch Storm 4th is a good out to have as a way to get rid of the gen monster and then follow it up by tribute summoning a fiend, which will then probably clear over another monster. If it's Majesty's Fiend, that means they can't even Valkyries. And then at that point, you're pretty far ahead when it seemed like it was a losing game before, because usually the investment to summon a gen monster is really high. Although you usually don't summon a Ginned Monster against Burning Abyss unless it's very late in the game, because they have access to cards like Karma Cut, Phoenix Wing, Blast, Rageki Break, etc., and Farfa. It's very, very easy for them to get rid of a Gin.
So that's a lot of cards to put in. What do you take out of your deck if you're just in Husky?
I'm looking at cards like Dimensional Prison and just the one-for-one removal that might not be that great. Even cards like Fire Lake might not be the best. It's basically anything that seems like a more fair card. You know, I'm only using one card to stop one card, etc. Those are the kind of cards I don't want in my deck. Something that responds to attacks, whereas Necroz of Trishula is the reason I'm losing the games. I think those are the kind of cards you'd side out.
Okay. In Gallo's side deck, we have Zephyr Saber, Swordmaster of the Necroz, which is the new Pendulum monster that is also a Necroz monster that works like a ritual spell card.
Yeah,
that's a cool card. 2 copies of Neko Seka, 1 Necroz of Gugnir, 1 Mystical Space Typhoon, 2 copies of Necro Valley, 2 copies of Mirror Force, 2 Royal Decrees, 3 Breakthrough Skill, and 1 Vanity's Emptiness.
Yeah, so we'll probably just see Galo put in cards like the Royal Decrees, things that stop trap cards, as well as cards like Breakthrough Skill to mitigate the fiends. Galo starts out pretty standard here, summoning Senju, discarding Bryonitad, Necroz of Unicorn. It's interesting that he does it like this, because that usually means that he's either going to use the Unicorn to get back the Bryonic, or he's specifically putting the Bryonic in the grave for a reason for later, because otherwise you can just go straight to Unicorn. He might also be doing it to bluff a Valkyries because he doesn't have one yet, etc.
Preparation of Rites. He'll use it to add Necroz of Colossalis to his hand, and then send Necroz of Colossalis to the graveyard to add Necro's Kaleidoscope to his hand.
Yeah, and this explains exactly why he sent the Bryonic, because here he'll activate Necro's Kaleidoscope, send Herald of Arclight to summon Unicorn, and then he'll be able to get another card that's either Necro's Trishula or that could potentially search Necro's Trishula, and he already has the 6 and the 3 in his graveyard in order to summon it later. However, he's chosen to go for Necro's Cycle, which means he's probably going to try to summon Gin Releaser Rituals, or summon a Ritual Monster
definitely
using the effect
like
of... And release it really
definitely
chose.
Looks like it. He's activating the effective as the Ball Chain. And as you said before, he has decided to send Jin, Releaser of Rituals, from his deck to his graveyard. With that card in his graveyard and Necro Cycle able to special summon monsters from the graveyard, he's all set to special summon Necros of Colossalis by banishing that Jin. Do you like this play against Burning Abyss deck?
No, I mentioned earlier how I don't think it's the best. Maybe because he has Mystical Space Typhoon, he feels a little more protected because, for example, Husky has Karma Cut in his hand, so he'll have to set a trap card to try to get rid of the Jin, and then you can end-phase Mystical Space Typhoon it so he can't activate it yet, thus destroying it, and then so the Jin's safe. However, we also see that he has Mathematician, a copy of Farfa, and all these other cards that can also remove the Jin to Colossalis, although temporarily it will still cause it to, quote-unquote, forget whether or not it was ginned.
Yes, there's a lot of cards that he can use to get rid of it. There's 2 copies of Mathematician that can send Farfa to the graveyard, which would get rid of Colossalis for the turn to remove the effect of the gin. 3 copies of Farfa in his deck, 2 copies of Dark Hole, a copy of Raigeki, Book of Moon, 3 copies of Karma Cut, Fire Lake of the Burning Abyss, as well as, if he added it to his main deck from the side deck, 2 copies of the Monarch Storm 4th. So that Necroz of Colossalis is not likely to stick around.
Exactly. And here he might even just attack with the Mathematician with the Lavalval Chain. get a draw, and then set something like Karma Cut. So then if Galo tries to move in with Necroz of Trishula, he can just chain the one trap card because he's already gotten rid of his monster. But it looks like he's just going to choose not to. However, here, although Galo didn't set up for a Necroz of Trishula, he's still very, very close, like one card away from being able to do it. He can put a Mandu or Senju on top of the deck with the effect of Evolve All Chain, so then he can guarantee Trishula the next turn. So I think that's might be what he ends up doing. Necroz of Colossus also just plays an important role with its effect that says during either player's turn, you can target a face-up extra deck monster, negate its effect, and its attack goes to zero. So in that way, he's also protected from cards like Dante. If Husky summons Masked Hero Darklaw, he can negate its effect so it doesn't destroy the Colossus, then negate its effect again next turn. So even if the Necroz of Colossus isn't summoned via Jin, or now it doesn't remember that it was summoned via Jin, it still serves the purpose of being able to mitigate extra deck monsters and protect Galo. So that's very, very important. So we see him doing exactly what I said before. He's just putting Mandu on top of his deck. There's not much else he can actually do. Like, his options are basically he can't activate any of the other cards in his hand, so it's just either what am I going to put on top of my deck with a Evolve Chain, or what am I going to send to the graveyard with my Evolve Chain.
Right. He has Necroz Mirror, Raigeki, and Shurit Strategist of the Necroz in his hand. The Necroz Mirror lets him tribute banish monsters from his graveyard to pay tribute for Ritual Monsters, and the Shurit also works to pay the entire tribute for Ritual Monster, but he's missing the actual Ritual Monster that he can summon.
Correct. It was also, if Galo sided a card in, like, Breakthrough Seal, he could have just sent Breakthrough Skill to the graveyard with the Evolve All Chain to play around a later Vanish Fiend or Majesty's Fiend, but because Galo has Raigeki in his hand, he already feels safe against those kinds of cards, and he doesn't need to necessarily send the Breakthrough Skill. So that's also important to note.
Now, is the Majesty's Fiend and Vanity's Fiend inclusion in Burning Abyss decks standard enough that Galo would expect Husky to have it?
It's been Burning Abyss itself hasn't been the most popular deck recently. We've seen a lot of Shadals, a lot of Cool Fort, absurd amount of Necroz, and then a little bit of Teller Knights here and there. But Burning Abyss seems to have fallen off in terms that it's probably the fifth most popular deck. And because Burning Abyss was so dominant in previous formats and those inclusions happened before, it wouldn't be outlandish to feel like, oh, I need to expect this.
Okay, so what happened here was Justin summoned Liebig to the field. It was destroyed by its own effect because the Mathematician was on the field. He special summoned Farfa from his hand. Farfa's effect was negated, so it was not destroyed. He Xyz summoned Dante, Traveler of the Burning Abyss, by combining Farfa with Mathematician, and then activated its effect to send three cards from the top of his deck to his graveyard. Can't tell what all three of those are, unfortunately.
Okay, so he sent two copies of Graf and an additional Libic. So basically what can happen here is he activates the effect of the Farfa, and the Farfa banishes the Colossus, but in response, Galo uses Colossus to negate the effect of Dante. And then the Graf activates, or the Graf actually should chain on before that, but the whole point is then the Graf lets him get a Sir from his deck. Oh. And now he can special summon Rubik, which he's playing a single copy of, knowing that he can get it with Graf, Skarm, and bring it back with Sir. So he can even use multiple Virgils with the single copy of Rubik if he wanted to. He can also just use it as an additional name, like you want to be able to special summon as many Burning Abyss you want in turn.
So here is his second copy of Dante, Traveler of the Burning Abyss. Once again, he is activating its effect, this time by detaching Sir as an Xyz material. That allows him to send three more cards from the top of his deck to his graveyard, and then with Sir's effect, I don't believe he has used Sir's effect this turn, he can special summon a Burning Abyss from his graveyard.
Indeed he can. So now, if Galo didn't know about the Majesty's Fiend, he knows, which also means that he'll side any card that hits Majesty's Fiend will most likely also hit Vanish Fiend. It's usually not the other way around, though, because some cards that are good against Vanish Fiend aren't necessarily good against Majesty's Fiend, because if it's an effect-based monster, it won't do anything to Majesty's Fiend. So specifically because he saw the Majesty's Fiend, it's better than seeing the Vanish Fiend. So as you said, he's going to get back a Graf with Sir. He hasn't used Skarm's effect yet, and that was the last card in his hand, so this is why he's trying to just set up as big of a board as possible, deal as much damage, and hope to win through that. I'm not sure if he'll... He also might just choose not to attack, but I think he will, but the... Yeah, actually, no. He would for sure attack because he knows that Galo's top card is Mandu. I was going to say that he could potentially not attack because that means he can't banish his ritual spells from his grave because he controls a monster. But he also already, like, because he could just put the Dantes in defense or just leave them in attack mode. They have 1,000 attack. Even though that might have been a misstep, he could have just summoned them in defense. But the whole point was he didn't necessarily have to attack, and that was a line that he could have made. But he also gets back the Colossal Self of Farfa anyway. So what I said doesn't really matter because he can still attack, and then during the end phase, the Colossal Self comes back.
Right.
He'll have a monster in play, so it won't be the biggest deal.
Yeah, it looks like this is a lot of damage, actually.
Yeah. Well, the Dante's effect was negated. I'm not sure what that will do in terms of damage. I'm pretty sure it turns his attack back to 1,000 because the way that monsters' effects that increase attack work is if they increase the attack of other cards, even if it's effect veiled after, it'll remain. However, or if the effect's negated after, it'll remain. However, if it only affects itself, if its effect's negated later, it will reduce back.
Okay, so in main phase two, we see a lot of Ixiz summons. He combined his Skarm with his Graf to Ixiz summon Equipped Engineer, and then Ixiz summoned two Downard Magicians by placing them on top of his copies of Dante. So now he has three Ixiz monsters on the field.
Yeah, and specifically what this does is Necros of Bryonic has an effect that says you can target up to two face-up monsters that were special summoned from the extra deck and return them to the extra deck. So by putting Downer Magicians on top of his Dantes, he guarantees that the Dantes will go to the graveyard. Whereas otherwise, if he just leaves the Dantes face-up, they can be returned to the extra deck by Bryonic, and then he won't get their effects. But Galo has Raigeki here. He's probably just going to like make things as simple as possible, clear the board. Huskey is considering chaining mech-equipped Engineer on something, which Galo will just target and negate with Colossus anyway.
That won't stop him from trying. That will not stop him from trying. He will use the effect of his mech-equipped Engineer, and as you stated before, Colossus is just going to stop it.
Yeah.
But that is a lot of cards sent to the graveyard, and a lot of their effects will now activate.
So yeah, we have two copies of Dante hitting the grave, as well as a copy of Graf, and then a Skarm as relevant effects. The Skarm will wait till the end phase, but the Graf and both copies of Dante will work now. It's actually interesting where he might not have wanted to use Colossus there, because even though we know that Husky's back row is a dark hole and it's not a chain bowl, he could potentially leave a face-up monster on the field, right, to guarantee that Necroz Attritional will resolve, because now Husky's adding a bunch of cards to his hand. He's probably going to special summon a monster to the field, and he'll have so many cards that he's very susceptible to Necroz Attritional.
That's a good point. That's definitely would be a valid play, although it's very counterintuitive.
I agree. Like
that your opponent would make a play to protect his own monster, and then you would interfere to destroy that monster. It's counterintuitive to think that would not be a good play.
Yeah.
And it's not costing him anything to do it. All he had to do was point at his Necros of Colossus.
Yeah, exactly. I think both plays are defendable, because even if he's just doing this, he's still playing for card advantage, getting through cards. You know, effectively, Necros has the better long game because it's so good at managing resources, like we mentioned earlier. Then just getting through cards is important. So he could easily just be doing that. And there's the chance that the trap card may be something like Vayne's Emptiness, which could be a much bigger deal, or a Mind Crush, which could stop Trishula. And then Galo's plan was just kind of like, oh, maybe I should have just played safer. Galo's line is for sure safer.
It doesn't matter, actually, because he had to special summon a monster with Graf's effect, right? Is that how that Sir hit the field?
Yes, but he could have just chose not to use the Graf's effect, which
he
is...
He might have chose... He could have foregone that effect. That's a lot to give up, though.
Yeah.
For the risk of a Trishula. You'd be giving up the protection of a monster, the summon of a Graf.
Yeah. What it would have maybe told Galo by Husky not getting Graf there was that the back row might have been a chainable. So then he can for sure clear out his board, but by him special summoning a Sir off the Graf, it probably means his back row is not chainable. So yeah, here we see him summon the Manju, search Trishula like he had planned before, activate Necrozmir, tribute Shrit, so he's going to get a Shrit effect. He banishes a Sir, a Graf, and a Skarm, I believe. He banishes Skarm from the grave, so it won't activate during the end phase because it was sent to the graveyard this turn. He gets rid of the Sir that was in play, gets a Graf out of the hand. Because Husky didn't use Seer previously in the turn, it's for sure correct to hit Seer here. But I initially had thought that maybe he had use here. In that case, you'd probably just banish the back row at resolution, but Gallo's play was correct. Okay. It swings in for 4,100 and should put Huskey down to 39. We talked about earlier how Necroz of Colossals is just powerful as a way to stop effects. However, because Gallo did not banish the back row, Huskey can now flip Darkhold, reclaim the board, although that's not the biggest deal against Necroz because they're efficient graveyard resource management. It still gets you somewhere.
Yeah, it definitely might put him back in the duel when he would otherwise have been in much poorer shape.
Indeed.
I'm still thinking about that thing you said earlier about that equipped engineer, and the more I think about it, the more I think maybe he should not have activated the effect, because by activating the effect, he actually gave Galo the choice of whether or not he keeps his monster.
Exactly.
And Galo has more information. So from you know, as a pure game theory element, he gave Galo total control over his decision.
Exactly.
And he could have just eliminated that decision by allowing it to be destroyed.
Yeah. If he would just let it go away, he could have just, like, kind of bluffed the fact, oh, I have Necroz of Trishula. Because Galo realizes that because John Huskey has made it to the top 32, he's most likely not going to make a misstep, like not use a Necroz of, or a Mequipped Engineer when he summoned it just to do that.
Right, yeah, so that's interesting. That's something that players notice at this higher level of play, and it's probably something they both thought about when it happened.
Yeah, so here we see him summon both Seer and Skarm. He normal summoned the Seer, special summoned the Skarm, and then overlaid for Dante, then detached the Seer that was normal summoned so he could get its effect. He sent Majesty's Fiend, Raigeki, and I believe another copy of Sir to the grave. And now he's going to special summon back a monster. It may be Dante. It's interesting also to note that if the Sir special summons the Dante, Bryonic won't be able to return that specific Dante back to the extra deck because it was special summoned from the graveyard. And even though it's an Xyz monster, it sees that it knows where the last place it was summoned from. So the Bryonic would not be able to do anything here. But it looks like he's just going to continue, get a graph, push for damage. And so
yep,
we'll see. Yep. Two attacks, 3,500 should put Galo down to 2,000.
That dark hole was fantastic. Dante, of course, switches to defense mode at the end of the battle.
I think, Galo searched Necroz of Valkyries here, which might not have been. It seems very, very safe, right? Because you have this big board, and you think, oh, unless he can attack with something big, he's not going to be able to clear it, but obviously, cards like removal spells, Darkhold, Raigeki can get over it. And the Necroz of Valkyries doesn't really do anything. You have a high enough life total, 5,500, where him, with only three cards, being able to destroy your whole board and then deal that much damage is probably very unlikely. But here, we see Galo draw Senju, and Manju of the 10,000 hands and Senju of the 1,000 hands are basically key pieces to why Necroz is so powerful, because it gives you monsters that you can just draw. They search for almost anything, and you can keep going from there. However, Galo has used a lot of resources. We saw him kind of use a lot of unicorns in the last game really fast. I think he's been a little better on resource management this game, but I don't think it'll come back to bite him, but it's kind of close. Here he can just banish the ritual spells and some ritual monsters, get more ritual spells to his hand. He can do a kaleidoscope play for a Necroz of Unicorn, sending Arclight, get another card. He can even make Digusto Emerald to shuffle back monsters into his deck, get more resources, and then he'll probably see. I assume he's going to do something involving possibly Dweller, like summoning Senju, searching the Unicorn, using the Necroz of Kaleidoscope. He's going to search off of one of these ritual spells, summon the Unicorn, search a way to summon the Valkyries in his hand, make a Dweller, summon the Valkyries. So then the Dweller is at 2,200 because of the Unicorn. Valkyries will be at 3,400. He'll be able to attack over the whole board and use the Dweller by detaching the Senju, keeping the boost, and mitigating all of Husky's effects.
So for those who don't know, Abyss Dweller is a rank 4 Xyz monster that you can summon by combining two level 4 monsters. It has 1,700 attack, but if one of the Xyz materials is a water monster, it gains an additional 500 attack, going up to 2,200. Abyss Dweller is a big card against Burning Abyss decks, because by detaching an Xyz material from it, you can negate the effects of all cards that activate in the graveyard for the turn. Since Burning Abyss monsters almost all activate effects in the when they're sent to the graveyard in any way, Abyss Dweller can just stop all of them.
Indeed.
So now we're going to see Galo banish a Necroz ritual spell card along with Necroz monster to add a Necro's Ritual spell card to his hand. Then he does it again to add a Necro's Mirror.
It might be interesting here. Oh, yeah, okay, he doesn't short strategies from the Necros. I was going to say maybe he can't summon the Necros of Valkyries, like he doesn't have the necessary material.
Yeah, well, he has Sengu, right?
Yeah, but he needs to use it to summon the Dweller. And in my line, he needs to overlay it. And he can only banish Necros monsters from his graveyard with Necros Mirror, but because he has the Shrit, he can use it for the whole cost and be fine with it. I'm pretty sure that's the line he's going to take. He's nodding his head like he knows what he's going to do. So he could have easily thought of something better because there's so much you can do from this position. But I think the line I mentioned previously, because he has a Dweller effect during his opponent's turn too, because he'll only use one material this turn, he's very, very safe. The worst thing that Huskey can draw is something like another Dark Hole or a Raigeki. And even then, that's kind of unlikely. If Galo chose to side in his Necros of Gungnir, he can even search it to protect the Valkyries. Because Necros of Gungnir says during either player's turn, you can discard it, target a Necros monster, and it can't be destroyed by Valor card effect. So right now he's searching for Herald of Arclight that he sent to the graveyard off of Necros Kaleidoscope, and he's 7 Necros Unicorn. So he's trying to decide what line he's exactly going to go with. He searches another copy of Unicorn, which... Oh, I see. Okay, so he might actually... It's interesting because he could potentially Trishula his opponent again. He could have used Necroz Unicorn to add back Necroz or a Shred Strategist of the Necroz, and then activate Necroz Cycle to discard that to add the to Special Summon. Yeah, so he uses Cycle to tribute the Shred to Special Summon the Necroz of Trishula, but that's not the line he's going with. He specifically went Necroz of Unicorn to get Bryonic to get the last Shred from his deck, which he wanted to use two Shreds that turn, and that's why he did it, because he needed one Shred to banish for the Necros of Valkyries and one Shrit to pay for the cost of Bryonic. So Galo basically found a better way to do the play I previously mentioned because he got an extra monster into play. Now Necros of Bryonic gets to remove the Dante, put it back to the extra deck, put out enough damage for Galo to win, and that'll be it.
Yes, so that was a fast last turn. He played all his cards quickly, but in the end... He just summoned three monsters. One of them was an Abyss Dweller. The Abyss Dweller was enough to shut down all of the effects on Husky's side of the field that would otherwise protect him when they're sent to the graveyard. And by doing so, he was able to win that duel and the match.
Yeah.
So Galo is moving on to the top 16 with his Necros deck. His deck does feature Camera Clops, but we did not see it on camera.
Yeah, he also main decks a single copy of Dango Cycle, which we didn't talk about before, but would have been a very, very good card against Burning Abyss.
That's true.
Yeah. One last thing to note was that Galo's last turn, he used all three of his ritual spells, which kind of shows Galo's adept mastery of the deck, like knowing that he can optimally use his turn. Like, my play only involved two ritual spells, right? But realizing that he would have extra cards in the process, he just thought about, well, how can I also use Cycle this turn without costing my other plays, and by doing that, he was able to win a game there, whereas my play would have just put him in a very commanding position, but giving Huskey another turn to draw a card. But yeah, it's still impressive that Huskey was able to go this far in the tournament with Burning Abyss. Masquerade Darklore most definitely plays a role. I'm sure the Vanes and Magic Fiends also did. It would have been interesting there to see Huskey draw Stormforth and a Fiend after Galo had made such a strong turn one.
Had Huskey been able to summon a Majesty's Fiend or a Vanity's Fiend, that would have been a very different duel. Many times the Necros duelists can't overcome cards like that really restrict their plays, and that's enough to win it.
Yeah. Well, it was different here because Galo had the Raigeki in his opener, so even if Huskey was able to manage to do all that, He still had the Raigeki removed. Galo just showed his opponent they also side in and copies a breakthrough skill. So even then, he has more cards to beat the Fiend. So Galo knew, or he presumed. That. Even if the Burning Abyss players don't use Majesty Fiend or Vanity's Fiend, they sometimes side cards like Spell Canceller. Play a very similar role, just negating all the spells, making so they can't ritual summon.
Do you think Galo might have added the Zephyr Saber, Swordmaster of the Necros to his deck in case of that Spell Canceller?
Possibly. He also, but the reason I wouldn't think so is because he doesn't play Necros of Decisive Armor, which, when paired with a monster such as Zephyr Saber or Dance Princess of Necros or Great Sorcerer of the Necros, which you can normal summon and attack with, you could potentially attack with it on a Vanity's Fiend or a Spell Canceller and then use Decisive Armor to beat it. So, yeah, I don't think he necessarily did. I think Spell Canceller is significantly less popular than the Fiends right now. Yeah. So that's a big reason. The only other card you'd probably want to answer is something like Anti-Spell Fragrance, which also isn't very popular in Burning Abyss. They kind of have to build their deck around it by using multiple cards like Fire Lake, causing their opponent to set all their cards and then blow them away. So, yeah, I don't think he did, but he also knew he could go to Game 3. So if he did happen to lose a game to something like Spell Cancer, he could have put it in for Game 3, but he also had answers with Breakthrough Skill, etc. in his deck. So, and I'm pretty sure Camera Clops has low enough attack where it can beat a Spell Canceler, but Spell Canceler stops him from activating reinforcements of the army, so he would have just had to draw the Camera Clops.
Yeah. It's a lot harder to draw a card naturally than to add it to your hand with several cards that can search for it.
Exactly.
And that's basically a common theme of Necro's decks, because they're constantly searching for cards. More often than not, those cards are added to your hand and not drawn during your draw phase.
Exactly. And this is why cards like Mass Hero Dark Law and Mistake are so effective. Even Shared Ride. We haven't seen Shared Ride in a while, even though that seems to be one of the best cards in the Necro's Mirror specifically. Galo has chosen to include no copies. So.
That's true. I don't think I've actually seen a Shared Ride activated on camera all weekend.
Yeah, I think that's in response to the move towards cards like Solemn Scolding. Because that version of the deck wants to go first a lot of the time. Like, they don't actually want to go first, but by going first, they can set up a Necroz Ritual Monsters that are summoned via Djinn Releaser Rituals. Then set Solemn Scolding, which lets them protect it. Solemn Scolding says you can pay 3,000 life points, negate the normal summon of a monster, the activation of a spell or trap, or the activation of a monster's effect. So basically can stop whatever they're trying to do to be your Djinn.
But I haven't seen a Solemn Scolding this weekend either.
Yes, but... So. I think one is, like, maybe the duels moved away from Solemn Scolding, but also fearing Solemn Scolding, they realized, like, oh, maybe Share Ride isn't the best inclusion in my deck. It's arguable both, but they're most definitely trends that are interesting. Also, Danko Sekka. Some players might have chosen to main Danko Sekka this weekend, which also causes problems in the mirror match because a lot of players choose to side out the Djinn or Vayne's Empty Mist to try to make the mirror match more fair in some ways. And then in those matchups, they'll side in cards like Danko Sekka because they can catch them on a Shared Ride, summon Danko Sekka, and then be able to guarantee a Necroz of Trishula on them while they have a set card.
Yeah, we've been seeing a lot of Danko Sekka for a while. At the last YCS in Chicago, it was a popular card. And it does appear to be a popular card again this weekend. Even when it doesn't make it into a Duelist main deck, a lot of Duelists are using it in their side deck. Galo is using one copy of Danko Sekka in his main deck, plus two copies of Danko Sekka in his side deck.
Indeed, it's usually the best type of card against strategies such as Citadel Knights or Burning Abyss, etc. So I think that will be all for us this round. We'll be back in top 16. For now, we're going to play a playback from round 5 with Jeffrey Jones versus Mike Avalanese. It's a good match. Necroz versus Shadals really showcases how powerful Shadals can be built against Necroz. Hope you guys enjoy it. We'll be back shortly.